This program is brought to you by Emory University.
We want to get started on time so that we can also get you out by 5:30. That's what we're shooting for. And we've got a few things to do, all right? So let me do very quickly say to you that part of our relationship between Emory and the National Institute for Trial Advocacy, as I told you at the beginning, goes back to the very beginning of NIDA and the very beginning of this program. One of the folks that has helped us today and yesterday in the program is the executive director of the National Institute for Trial Advocacy, Karen Lockwood. And Karen is going to just address you for a few minutes here before we get started. Karen?
Paul. So I have applause for the faculty, but I have especially applause for the students. One question: how many of you have changed your skills in the last 2 days? Learned anything? Hands up. That is distinction. Now, Emory is very delighted to be distinguished by this program, and it is a wonderful and hallmark program, Paul. Congratulations to all of you. My question for you is, when you graduate and you tell anyone, whether you're in litigation or administrative litigation or even business, I went to Emory, they will know what about you? Oh, you must have done that amazing program. And don't you then distinguish yourself from those around you? Of course. So then, if you're thinking about this, the puzzle will be, what do I do in 3 or 4 years when everyone else knows what I know now? So I want to tell you about 2 minutes of the NIDA history. 45 years ago this year, trial judges, law professors, and practitioners got together and said, with the ABA and the Supreme Court telling us, we need to do more to teach law students trial ad before they get out of school. And since they're not yet at that level, we need to do more to teach young practitioners and senior practitioners more. They gave birth to NIDA, and around a kitchen table for many months, they designed and gave birth to the method that you are seeing used in your classrooms to accomplish your skills. So, back to distinction. This is an abject invitation to join our community. When you move on and you want to repeat something like this, but at a higher level, we are here for you. This is what we do. When you get out in your first year of practice and you want some quick information, get online. You can stream our webinars, which are free. You can join live webinars. We have some of our faculty here and others live for an hour talking about specific issues that there's not time to talk about in a program, but they're equally important. So I want to welcome you to the NIDA community. You really are part of us, and I hope you'll stay part of us. And thank you for inviting us all here, Paul.
Thank you. So just a quick heads up about tomorrow. As you know, tomorrow we have the second expert to work through during the morning tomorrow. And then if you've looked at the schedule, you know that tomorrow afternoon is free for preparation for the motion. And please, I know that many of you have saved up, like good trial lawyers, the times for the breaks for doing personal things and taking care of and maybe getting a workout in and all of those things, but recognize this responsibility you have to each other to make yourselves available to each other to prepare for the hearing. You're going to be each other's witnesses. You know, you've been working with witnesses without preparing those witnesses. Now you'll have to work together in order to really be able to make your direct or cross-examination, your direct examination, sing together as you move through it. So make yourselves available. You know that. You've been broken into your groups, but I wanted to make sure that there's a heads up for that. Now, we had a problem in the schedule this year because we're doing the motions as opposed to doing a bench trial. Usually what we would do would be opening statements before you would go into your bench trial. and then have you do tomorrow morning openings. But because we're doing this expert thing, we're not doing it that way. So we have to give you some information about closings now for after the bench trials, for Wednesday morning. So after you do your bench trials, Wednesday morning, you're going to come in and do closing argument. Now, it makes some sense to do it now. One, because the last thing you want to do on Tuesday night is come back for a closing demonstration. You'll have a buzz from being up and doing your hearing, but you won't want to come back. So it makes some sense to do that now. But number two, it's because part of the argument you will be making, I hope, will be informed by what you're going to see here in a few minutes. And that is closing arguments for jurors. These are jury trial closing arguments. And it's important to think about already what you've learned about argument, whether it's in your moot court experience or whether it's in your motion practice stuff from the first year, and start to think about how the argument looks differently when you're putting it on before a jury. Now, what we were going to see here without any interruption except for a keeping of time are two closing arguments. Now, this is going to be something we're going to give you, and I'll remind you about the resources you have to think about closing, and I hope you'll pull some of those resources back out on Tuesday night before you come in for closings. One, don't forget about these great videos about closing argument. So go to those videos Tuesday night and look at those videos. There's instruction and examples there that'll help you get ready. Number two, just remind you that there are resources from the normative guide that also give you some suggestions about how to put a good closing argument together. And then also recognize that what you're going to see here is meant to be a teaching demo. So please go to work and look and listen to what these folks are doing. And if something looks like you could use it, steal it. Right? This is available for you to use and think about how it incorporates into your theories and your themes as you're going to go and watch these demos. What you will see is these are arguments. And one of the things that you will have to think about is what's going to be the difference between an opening statement and a closing argument. These are arguments. You're going to hear lawyers make inferences from the evidence and tell you what it means. They will work themes in, they will tell stories, and so you will note that closing argument is like jazz, right? It has a structure to it, a theme and a structure to it, and there is room for really good argument. So, to get us going and get us started, Mike Ginsberg will address you in closing argument on behalf of Dr. Love. Mr. Ginsberg, are you ready to proceed?
I am, Your Honor. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the jury. I'm not going to show you Dr. Love's commercial again. We all know by now that it's a bit corny, isn't it? We laugh a little bit when we see that closing commercial and we say, wow, that's kind of silly. But you know what? It works, right? It's memorable. It works because it's corny. And we've all seen commercials like this from lawyers and doctors, and they all work because you remember them. I remember it particularly because 30-some years ago when I was a young lawyer, my 4-year-old daughter came up to me one day and she said, "Daddy, I know where you work. You work at Pecorio and Pecorio, attorneys at law." I said, "Pecorio and Pecorio, attorneys at law? What makes you think I work there?" "Well, I see it on TV. I see it on TV." And she remembered it because it was catchy. And we know here that Dr. Love's commercial works because 74% of the people in Central City know of Dr. Love from his commercials. It works. It's a slogan that people recognize. And it's meaningful because of that. You know, in this country, we value ideas. We protect, we respect, and we reward ideas. Think about going back to the very beginning of this country. Our founding fathers had ideas. They had an idea about how to rule this country, how to govern. Thomas Edison had ideas. We still think about the light bulb, General Electric. That all came from one man's ideas. And for centuries, we've rewarded and we've protected and we've respected those ideas. George Westinghouse, right? George Westinghouse, another man who had ideas. And we remember George Westinghouse. And we protect and we respect and we reward his ideas. How about this one? Anybody know who that is? That's Joy Mangano. She invented a mop. They just made a movie about Joy Mangano, right? Starring Jennifer Lawrence. Huge movie. And why? Because she invented something. And in this country, what? We protect, we respect, and we reward ideas. And that's what this case is about. Protecting, respecting, and rewarding ideas. This is Dr. Love's idea. He said, I want to make something of my cosmetic surgery practice. I'm going to talk about it. I'm going to tell people about it. I'm going to market it. I'm going to have a slogan. I'm going to call it the Love Look. And it worked. 74% of the people in Central City know who Dr. Love is because of his marketing. Dr. Love protected his idea. When Regency came into his community, when Regency came into Dr. Love's community, he said, stop. You're using my slogan. You're taking my idea. Stop it. And we know that Regency knew that his idea was there. How do we know that? Because they learned about it way back when they started using the Look of Love. This is the letter you saw from Urban Concepts. Urban Concepts was hired, you'll recall, by Regency to evaluate their slogan, the Look of Love. And what did they learn? They learned that Dr. Love was using a similar slogan, right? They learned that. And they dismiss it for three reasons. They say, because Dr. Love has not registered his slogan, we can use it. Because Dr. Love is not a plastic surgeon, we're not infringing. And three, because his practice is geographically remote. Geographically remote, it's not a problem for us. Well, they were wrong. They were completely wrong, right? We know that. Dr. Love didn't need to register a slogan for it to be valid. In this state, his use of the slogan makes it valid. He didn't have to register a slogan. They were wrong on that. They gave bad advice to Regency. Second, they were wrong when they said Dr. Love doesn't perform plastic surgery. He does. If they had even looked at the advertisements that Dr. Love was using, they would have seen that that's in fact what he does. He does plastic surgery. They were wrong. And most importantly, when Regency came in 2010 to Central City, Dr. Love's practice was no longer geographically remote. They were wrong. And Regency infringed. Now, what does Dr. Segan say about this, right? Remember Dr. Segan? She's the president of Regency. She's dismissive. What does she say? She says, we've been using this slogan, and we have a patent, and registered in the Patent and Trademark Office. Who cares? Dr. Love had it first. Who cares what she says? But she's dismissive. Oh, we've got a trademark on ours, and it's more important than yours. We're going to contend. We intend to continue our marketing campaign. It says it right there. We intend to continue our marketing campaign. Go away, Dr. Love. We're coming to your community. We're going to use your slogan, and we don't care what you say. We intend to continue. And then she says, we will not compete with you for airtime or for your dermatology patients. Wow, you're a dermatologist, and we're plastic surgeons. We're better than you. We're better than you, and so we're going to dismiss you altogether. And that's what they did. They didn't care. They dismissed Dr. Love, and they stole his trademark. I wish you continued success in your dermatology practice. Wow. Awfully kind of her to wish him continued success. I'm going to take your slogan. We're going to come into your area. We're going to compete against you. We wish you success, Mr. Dermatologist. At the end of the trial, at the end of these arguments, the judge is going to give you instructions, and I want to talk about those instructions because they're important for how you evaluate this case. The first instruction he's going to give you is instruction number 7. Let me go back. Instruction 7 is an instruction that says that the slogan has to be fanciful, not merely descriptive. All right, fanciful, not merely descriptive. What does that mean? I suggest to you that fanciful means that it's not descriptive, right? If it's not descriptive, it's fanciful. If it's fanciful, it's not descriptive. They're just counters to one another. What would it be? What would it mean to make it a descriptive slogan? Well, if all the patients looked like Dr. Love when they were finished, then we would have a descriptive slogan, but they don't, right? He doesn't make people look like him. So the Love look can't be descriptive because they all look like Dr. Love. They don't all look the same after surgery. You can't say, okay, we go in to get the Love look, and now we all look the same. That's not true, right? They have different kinds of procedures. Some of them have eye surgery, eyelid surgery, right? Some of them have Botox. Some of them have chemical peels, all sorts of different procedures. The Love look is fanciful because it talks about what you're going to feel after you have the procedure. So what you're going to have after the procedure, it's not descriptive of what Dr. Love is doing. And then you have his commercial, right? If anything's fanciful, it's to look like her, right? That's what it's about. It's about the fantasy of being beautiful and young again. And that's what his commercial tells us, and that's what the slogan means. Then the judge is going to ask you, talk to you about instruction number 8. 8 is a complicated instruction because there's a bunch of different tests regarding whether there's infringement. The first one is the distinctiveness of plaintiff's slogan, the Love look. I'm not sure we really have to talk about it again, and I'm still not going to play you the commercial because I don't think anybody wants to see it again. It's still kind of kooky, right? But it's distinctive. 74% of the people know Dr. Love from his commercial. He's distinctive. The commercial is distinctive. And we have the flyer that goes with it. Clearly a distinctive commercial. The second test is the similarity of the services provided by the parties. Oh, that's interesting. Remember Dr. Segan's letter where she says, oh, we're not going to interfere with your dermatology practice. We have different things. We are plastic surgeons and you're a dermatologist. Well, let's look at the facts that we saw at trial about that. And by the way, if they are distinctive, right, McDonald's and Wendy's, those are distinctive slogans. And it's okay to compete. That's not what this case is about. It's okay to compete. But you know, if McDonald's uses Wendy, the little girl, in their advertisements, that would be wrong. And if Wendy's used the golden arches in their advertisement, that would be wrong. It's okay to compete. But to compete fairly, you have to use your own slogans. And that's what Dr. Love wants you to find. But here's the comparison. This is what Dr. Love does. Those are the procedures that he does in the plastic surgery realm. You've seen that exhibit. It shows you all the procedures he's done. What does Regency say? Well, Dr. Segan says, our surgeons do not do laser skin procedures, dermabrasions, spider or varicose vein procedures, or small procedures like mole removals. We leave those to our physician's assistants or to other specialties, most often dermatology, because they don't require the training and experience of board-certified plastic surgeons. But what she doesn't tell us is that, in fact, her practice, Regency, does all those procedures. Our surgeons, she says, don't do them, but Regency does. And it's Regency that's marketing using Dr. Love's slogan. This slide, and you'll remember this from the exhibits you've seen during the evidence, these are all the procedures that Regency does that Dr. Love does. Blepharoplasty, Botox, chemical peel, dermabrasion, collagen injections, laser resurfacing, liposuction, All of those are procedures that Dr. Love does, that Regency does. And yet they tell us we don't do those procedures. That's just not true. All right, similarity of the party slogans. The love look versus the look of love. Seems obvious, but we don't need it to be obvious because we have evidence. We have evidence. There's the look of love. There's the love look. The look of love and the love look. Interesting, both use a beautiful woman, smiling, looking like she's got a fresh face and young and youthful. Actual confusion, all right? So the similarities then lead to the actual confusion. We have evidence of that too. Look at the confusion evidence. Catherine Delp, you'll remember her, she came and she testified. And what did she say? Then I saw an ad in Central City Monthly for what I thought was Dr. Love's Oakdale office. I thought the ad was for Dr. Love because it used his name and was for cosmetic surgery, and so I assumed it was Dr. Love. That's confusion. Dr. Love testified. He said, I heard my wife greet one of our regular patients on the phone with a joke about our TV commercial. The patient wanted to make an appointment in our new Oakdale office. Well, you know, Oakdale is where Regency is, not where Dr. Love is. Confusion. The patient said she had seen an ad in Central City Monthly for our Oakdale office. I guess Central City Monthly is one of those Gucci publications that Regency talks about. Central City Monthly is where Dr. Love's office, Central City is where Dr. Love's office is. They're advertising the love look in Dr. Love's backyard. She was sure it was us because the ad used my name and slogan. My name and slogan. That's confusion. Not all. Dr. Love met a woman at a charity event. She says the same thing. She made an appointment there instead and wound up having the surgery done there. She had a surgery done at Regency because of the confusion. Because of the confusion. And by the way, she was disappointed with the results. Confusion. We had the experts go out and survey. And what do they find? 74% of the folks in Central City, I already mentioned this, have seen Dr. Love's commercial. More importantly, 52% have seen the Love Look advertisement. And if you add up these first three numbers, you'll see that 47% of the people who've seen the advertisement were confused. 47%. Nearly 50% of the people who saw it were confused by the Look of Love advertisement. They thought at first, or completely, that it was Dr. Love. That's confusion. And if you look further with reference to cosmetic surgery, do you believe the phrases the look of love and the love look are virtually identical, very similar, or somewhat similar? 85% of the respondents. 85% of the respondents believe those were similar or the same. It's stunning, actually, when you think about it. 85%. That's confusion. I think we've satisfied that element. And by the way, Regency's own expert testifies in her deposition. A small number of patients have mistakenly called Regency's Central City office in an attempt to reach Dr. Love. And you'll recall that Dr. Sagan testified the same way. She doesn't even work there, and she knew that Dr. Love's patients were calling Regency. So we know there's confusion, and we know there's confusion because Regency says, we kept Dr. Love's phone number, so when people called us by mistake, we could tell them where to call. And you might hear Regency's counsel say, oh, we sent all the patients over there. That's not the point. The point is the patients were calling the wrong place because they were using Dr. Love's slogan. They stole his idea. In this country, we protect, we respect, and we reward ideas. Instruction 8E. Any similarity of marketing channels. They make a lot about this. They say, oh, we advertise in print and you advertise on TV. Instruction doesn't say they have to be the same marketing channels. Is any similarity? Well, I guess they're going to argue, and maybe we'll hear this from Mr. Rothschild, that people who watch TV don't read magazines. Right? That's the only thing I can think of they're going to argue, because it's the same thing. They're reaching the same audience. We know that because of the survey results. And by the way, Regency's expert, remember her? What does she say? The parties in the main use different marketing channels, although there may be some overlap. That's their expert saying there may be some overlap. Instruction 8F, the likelihood of purchaser care in selecting a cosmetic surgery procedure. It goes to the question of whether somebody seeking a procedure is going to pay attention to who they're calling. Right? And we have Dr. Brantley to testify about that. You remember his testimony? He's the expert we brought in who's a doctor and a marketing expert with an MBA, and he says, in my 12 years of internal medicine practice in a 7-physician office, many patients ask to be seen for a specific concern, not to be seen by a specific physician. That's the key, isn't it? If they're calling Regency instead of Dr. Love, he's losing patients. That's what this case is about. He's losing patients because of the confusion created by the slogans. Thus, he concludes, if a patient intending to call Dr. Love's office mistakenly called Regency and asked for a facelift evaluation, the patient would wind up with an appointment at Regency. You want to know why Dr. Love filed this lawsuit? He told you. It's for that reason. For that reason. His patients are going to Regency because of the confusion. 8G, whether defendant intended to capitalize on plaintiff's slogan. You know, this is fascinating to me when I look at the numbers. Maybe it's because I'm a numbers guy and I like to see numbers. But you look at these numbers. Regency's story is, oh, we didn't mean to compete. We don't intend to compete. We don't do the same things. And yet, look at these numbers. First of all, Regency is aware of Dr. Love's slogan before they began using the Look of Love. We know that. Right? They had their eyes open. They walked into Central City into Oakdale, which is the Central City area, knowing Dr. Love was there. They knew it 6 years before they came. And they knew the slogans were the same. And then they expanded their existing services by acquiring the business in Oakdale, and then look at the procedures they're doing that are the same. And I went behind these procedures a little bit because I think it's very interesting. In the 5 years since they've started using the Look of Love slogan in Central City, they went from $0 to $198,000 a year in chemical peels, $100 to $400,000 in dermabrasions, and $0 to $528,000 in laser resurfacing. Those are dermatology procedures. That's fascinating, isn't it? That's, if you add those numbers up, it's over $1 million of new revenue doing what Dr. Love does. Doing what Dr. Love does. And guess what? Any evidence of their expansion of their cosmetic services, surgery services to more closely resemble plaintiffs? Well, Dr. Segan said in her deposition, we do different procedures. We do different procedures and we're engaged in different specialties. Different procedures and different specialties. I want to hear how counsel responds to that, because that's what she says in her depositions. We do different procedures and different specialties. It's not true. It's just not true. Look at this. These procedures, these are the same ones I highlighted before. Every one of those procedures highlighted Dr. Love does. Every one of those procedures.
5 minutes, counsel.
Thank you. Every one of those procedures. I already showed you this slide showing you how much those particular procedures have increased, but look at this. Blepharoplasty, this is the eyelid surgery. They went from $169,000 to $500,000 in 5 years. Oh, by the way, Dr. Segan says they don't do these procedures because Dr. Love does these procedures and they don't do the same procedures. But they do, and they went from $169,000 to $500,000. On Botox, they went from $29,900 to $204,700. Collagen injections, $20,000 to $164,000. In liposuction, in 5 years, they went from $241,000 to $819,000. Dr. Segan thinks they don't even do these procedures. It's a lot of money for procedures she says they don't do. The end of this closing process, judge is going to give you the instructions and then ask you to fill out a verdict form. This is what it looks like. First question says, is the slogan "the love look" as applied to Dr. Love's cosmetic surgery not merely descriptive of his surgery but a fanciful slogan? I'd ask that you check the box yes. Second question, did the defendant infringe on plaintiff's "the love look" slogan? Again, I'd ask you to check and answer this question yes. And finally, was the plaintiff damaged by defendant's infringement of plaintiff's "the love look" slogan? I'd ask you to answer that question in the affirmative yes also. Remember, in this country, we protect, we respect, and we reward ideas. And the way you do that is you protect them through the trademark, through the rights that Dr. Love acquired in the use of his trademark and in the use of his slogan and the business that he built by doing that. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. I would remind the court not to demonstrate your emotions and applaud. Keep an open mind until all of the arguments have been made.
May I proceed?
You may proceed, counsel.
I'd like to start by talking about plaintiff's star witness, Catherine Delp. Why do you suppose, when I was questioning her, did I talk to her about the fact that the real estate company that she owns represented Dr. Love and his wife when they sold their house? Or as the head of hospice, she recruited Dr. Love to make thousands of dollars of contributions to that fine cause. That she and the Loves sat together at the annual hospice event at her head table. How she and her son are still being treated for dermatology by Dr. Love. Or how Mrs. Love recruited her at that hospice event, convinced her to help them out and become a witness in this lawsuit. Those facts are things you need to consider as you judge what to make of her testimony. She is the only person who came to this court and testified before you that there was confusion. Yes, we heard a lot of hearsay. You've seen some of that displayed already. Double hearsay. Oh, I heard my wife talking to somebody on the phone and heard this, and I heard people at a restaurant, and I heard people here and there. Self-serving hearsay, to be sure. All from Dr. Love, not from some witness, but only Dr. Love. And the question is, can we trust what Dr. Love has to say? Remember yesterday when Dr. Love testified. When my co-counsel was questioning him, he wouldn't own up to anything. Not even that his longtime friend and personal accountant Sammy Forrester, was going to be one of his witnesses, was going to give you numbers to consider about his business. He wouldn't admit that Dr. Waters and Dr. Connolly, who he's known for years, seen at medical conventions, seen around town at different doctor meetings, he wouldn't admit that they're board-certified plastic surgeons. He knew full well they were board-certified plastic surgeons. But no, he won't admit to that. And as I listened to him duck and evade and not answer the questions that were being asked, clear, straightforward questions, it reminded me of a saying maybe some of you have heard. It's a hurt dog that howls. And Dr. Love was doing some serious howling yesterday afternoon in this courtroom. Even his lawyer, when we objected to some of this hearsay, what did his lawyer say? Well, we're not offering this for the truth of the matter asserted. Remember that legalese? We're not offering this for the truth. Well, then what the heck are you putting this information out here for? Aren't we here trying to discover the truth? What's the point? Whoever these people are that supposedly said things that Dr. Love overheard, who are they? What are their names? How come somebody didn't come here face to face with you and verify all of this supposed confusion? Not one person, even Ms. Delp, can testify that confusion led to harm. Oh, the star witness. What about Ms. Delp? She got what she wanted from the doctor she wanted, and that doctor was paid for those services. Regency didn't benefit financially one whit because Ms. Delp was confused and went to Regency at first. No harm, no foul. We know if Ms. Delp, when she called up, had asked to see Dr. Love, we know what would have happened. The people at the desk would have said, Dr. Love doesn't work here. He's down in Central City. Here's his phone number. And that would have been that. No harm, no foul. Well, why then do I bring up this close association between Ms. Delp and the Loves? Does it influence and motivate what she testified to before you? Well, she comes in here and she badmouths Regency. Oh, they're bad, they're bad. She comes in, she has an appointment. Yes, she was confused to begin with, for sure. The nurse talked to her. She talked to one of our doctors, a board-certified plastic surgeon. And what did that doctor say to her? Well, the first thing the doctor did was to advise her of all of the things that Regency does and can do for patients who come in there. What's wrong with that? Then, when the doctor found out that she was there really to see Dr. Love, and he said, he doesn't work here, he said, you know, he's only a dermatologist. He's not a board-certified plastic surgeon. What's wrong with that? It was the truth. And then she reports that he said to her, well, you know, for the kind of surgery that you want, where you're going to have an operation on your face, maybe you'd be better off having a board-certified plastic surgeon, someone with years of experience, with years of training in surgery on a face. What's wrong with that? Wouldn't you want your doctor to let you know what your options are and let you know if maybe this doctor with this specialty would be better for you than another doctor? What's wrong with that? This wasn't a hard sell, as she wants you to believe. It was an honest sell. And what's wrong with the doctor doing all of that? But we know that Bobby, Dr. Love's wife, at the hospice event, bad-mouthed Regency to Catherine Delp, told her from her perspective all about this terrible outfit and how her husband had to sue, and please, would you help out? So what is obviously nothing more than honest information being given to someone who comes in looking for that, it becomes a hard sell. Well, that's what happens when you have close ties with a party in a case. It can influence what you say. And she did. She came here and she was asked to help Dr. Love, and she did what she could to help Dr. Love. And Catherine Delp is the best they've got. But there's no harm. Dr. Love was paid. Regency wasn't paid anything. And common sense tells us that the few people that may have called Regency asking for Dr. Love, they were told, he doesn't work here, here's his phone number. What do you think they did? Well, they went and called Dr. Love and made an appointment. And we have a result from one of the surveys in this case which tells us that. It's the Woodward survey, question number 7. If you intended to schedule an appointment with a specific doctor but mistakenly called the wrong doctor's office, what would you do? 97% of the people said what we know to be obvious. Well, you're going to call the doctor you want to see, of course. Ah, but Mr. Ginsberg, he might get up here and try to explain this. Aha, we asked Regency, give us the names of your patients. Give us their phone numbers, give us their email, give us their mailing address, so we can contact them and find out if any of them went to Regency by mistake wanting to see Dr. Love, and if they actually paid Regency money. And it's true. We didn't provide that information, and we all know why, because there's a federal law called HIPAA that prohibits that type of privacy. It has to be kept confidential. And Dr. Love, when he was cross-examined, had my co-counsel had enough time to ask these questions, would have admitted to you that he would do the same. He wouldn't give that information up either, because he is under that same HIPAA law. But is that the end of it? Does that mean they couldn't have found people, if they exist, to support what they're trying to say here? Well, they could have. They could have done it in ways that Dr. Love is very familiar with. They could have put an ad on late night cable TV. Some of us have seen those ads, asking for people who have suffered asbestos injuries, who've worked in an environment where there was asbestos. Call 1-800 law office, right? Or we've seen ads in newspapers. Dr. Love has done that as well, looking for people who have information about lawsuits. They could have done that as well. But we know nothing of any of that. There hasn't been one person that's come in here and testified, yes, I was confused, yes, I went to Regency thinking Dr. Love, and yes, I actually paid money to Regency. Not one person has come in here to testify for that. Period. And you know, a trial is about proof. It's not about speculation. It's not about leaps of faith, where you take some information and you make who knows what out of it. No, it's about proof, and they have no proof of actual harm. Oh, they looked at the revenues. Interesting, the first year that Regency was competing with Dr. Love, Dr. Love's revenues went up. And then they went down. And they're trying to say, well, there's only one reason on the planet that the revenues went down. It's because of some slogan. Well, consider this. Regency has been successful everywhere they've gone. Why do you suppose they've been so successful? Besides having a stable of qualified, experienced plastic surgeons, they also are into advertising. Advertising that targets a certain audience. Advertising in which the slogan is but a small part. And even Mr. Anderson, remember Mr. Anderson, he told us, yeah, the slogan, that really wasn't what it was about. It was the entire look of this ad, the feel of the ad, the professionalism of the ad. That there were, and talked about confidence. There was a beautiful woman looking at herself in a mirror. It announced, not once, not twice, but three times. These are plastic surgeons, board certified, it said. And you can say Dr. Love does plastic surgery, but he does cosmetic surgery, not plastic surgery. They are different. So, we didn't advertise cheesy, humorous, call it what you will, on cable TV. No, we had high quality ads that were in fine magazines, in theaters, at concerts, announcing we have board certified plastic surgeons. They know what they're doing. You can trust them. So here's a question for you to think about. If somebody wants a doctor who's going to cut your face, a doctor who's going to suction out fat from your body, a doctor who is going to enlarge parts of your body, what are people going to do to choose somebody to conduct that kind of invasive procedure, risky procedure? Are they going to do it based on a slogan? Is that what it's going to be on? No. They're going to be careful. They're going to think about it. They're going to ponder it. They're going to research. They're going to talk with family. They're going to talk with friends before they make any decision at all. They're not going to base it on three words or four words that somebody put on an ad. And they raise the question, did we target Dr. Love? Well, at the time we came up with the look of Love, yes, we knew Dr. Love existed. He was in some faraway place. He was a dermatologist. His practice had nothing to do with what we were up to in New York City. We didn't come up with the look of Love to target him. We could have cared less about him. Were we trying to confuse people in Florida? In Georgia, in Connecticut, were we trying to confuse them because we were worried about Dr. Love? Not at all. And let's look at the ad. Look at this ad. And look especially at this word. The L is not capitalized. It's not the name of a person. We're not targeting Dr. Love with a capital L. We're talking about love as we all know it. You love someone else. You love life. You love yourself. You love the way you feel. It wasn't targeting Dr. Love at all. And Regency understood when it came to a new area, and it did that a number of times, that it had to let folks know that they were there and who they were and give them a sense of what their practice was about. And they were willing to spend money to do that. Money in advertising. And I wanted to talk about this for a second. I'm reminded. Advertising. Dr. Love, well, actually, when he testified, what were the words? I wrote it down here. He talked about Referral practice, yes, there it is. He called it a referral practice. That was his practice, a referral practice, to build his practice. And then remember when Mr. Stein questioned him about this, and he tried to get him to admit that he had said under oath before, word of mouth is really my best advertising. Do you remember how hard Mr. Stein, how hard it was for him to drag that out of him? He wouldn't even admit what he'd said earlier in this case under oath. So here's a question for you. Competition. What's wrong with competition? Our whole economy is based on that. Our whole system is based on that. It's called capitalism. There's nothing wrong with competition, but you already heard, and I'm sure you'll hear again, Dr. Love's lawyer will say, well, it's got to be fair. We agree, competition should be fair. And so I ask you, what's not fair about having better qualified doctors in your office? What's not fair about having more experienced doctors in your office? What's not fair about offering more surgical options to your patients? Is there something not fair about having better facilities and better equipment? Or having more people on staff and more doctors to do the job that the patients want? What's not fair about outspending your competition in the marketplace with your ads?
5 minutes, counsel.
Thank you. And I hope we can agree that these are very different businesses. I wanted to show you this, and I'm sorry I forgot. Talking about the advertising, remember this, it was Exhibit 6B, and here is where Regency laid out its advertising budget. And it's hard to figure that one out, so I added it all up. And how much over the 6 years did Regency spend to advertise in this area? Well, by gosh, it was over $1.3 million. Now, why would a company spend that much money in advertising? Because they knew it worked. It worked everywhere else that they practiced, too. It had nothing to do with any competition. They knew that when they came into an area and if they had good, solid advertising that targeted a certain audience, that gave a certain feel, that people would come, would check them out. And if they had good, experienced, qualified doctors, that their revenues would go up. Now these businesses, they're different. So let's look at some of the differences very quickly. Location, Oakdale, 25 miles north of Central City. It's a high-end community. And you know, those of you who are from Atlanta realize Marietta, it's farther than Marietta is from downtown Atlanta. That's only 20 miles away. So it's a long ways away. And very different people live there, upscale, high-end people who have money to pay for cosmetic procedures because it's not inexpensive at all. So here's the location. And we had facilities all over the East Coast even before we came here. What about our doctors? 2 to 3 surgeons, 1 dermatologist. Board certified in plastic surgery, board certified in dermatology. Training, 5 years of surgical in medical school, no surgical training in medical school for Dr. Love. Yes, he went to Chicago a couple of weeks and weekends and had some training that let him cut people's faces, but very different from 5 years of general and plastic surgical training. And here it is, put together in another way. Board certified, fellow, the surgical, and exclusive practice in only cosmetic and plastic surgery as compared to Dr. Love. What else? The procedures. Dr. Love does less than half of the procedures when you're talking about cosmetic surgery procedures. And here are they are, the list of the ones that Regency does that Dr. Love doesn't do. What else? Well, they have different payment plans, obviously, and advertising where they advertise. It's very different. And there's this. There's a big difference there, too. Because we registered, and Dr. Love, he didn't register. And not only that, remember yesterday, The man got brain dead and couldn't even remember that his advertisements didn't have an R with a circle. Did you really believe him that he didn't know and he didn't realize that he didn't have the right to put an R and he didn't put an R in his ads? And you're going to trust what this man tells you about all of this? But he says, oh, we have a common law trademark anyhow. Well, what does Love's slogan tell you? It describes the look you get when you go to Dr. Love. It's as simple as that. He shows pictures to his patients. Here's what somebody looks before. Here's what somebody looks like afterwards. That's the look you will get. That is called the Love look. It's kind of like going to a hairdresser and wondering, well, what will I look like if you give me this kind of a cut? And the hairdresser says, well, I can show you a picture. Here's somebody who I did this cut with, and you look at it. There's the look you get. He's not entitled to a common law trademark at all. And another survey result tells us that. Remember this one? Does it refer to Dr. Love's cosmetic surgical? 62%, yeah, that's descriptive, folks. Now, finally, I'd like you to think about what would have happened if, instead of using this advertisement, if Regency would have come in and done this, the look of life, begins with an L, four letters. What would have happened if Regency would have done that? Nothing really would have changed. They would have advertised this. It's just a slogan, but the overall impression of the ad, it's the same ad. It's a beautiful woman. It's confidence. It's classy. It's done professionally. It's not cheesy. And it would still bring people in the door. There would be no confusion at all. No infringement. And what would happen? Dr. Love revenues would have still gone down. Regency's revenues would have still gone up because they're highly qualified, and this brought people in the door to learn about that. No harm, no foul. And that's why, at the end of this case, we hope you'll agree that Dr. Love simply hasn't proven his case because he has no case. Thank you.
Hey, hold on. Order in the court. We've got, as you know, in the American adversarial system, a very brief rebuttal, and counsel reserved 5 minutes for rebuttal. Order in the court. Please give counsel your attention.
Is the mic on? Your Honor, I will be brief. I said earlier that there was an arrogance to Regency, and you just saw it again, right? You just saw it again. We've got a New York City company that knew that Dr. Love was using this slogan, the Love Look. They knew it, and they dismissed him and said, oh, he doesn't do what we do. And they were wrong about that. And Dr. Sagan continues to be wrong about that, and it doesn't matter to them. And they were wrong, and you just heard counsel said he didn't register his trademark. He did not need to register his trademark in this state. Maybe they need to go back to New York City and use those rules, because the rules here say he does not need to register the trademark to use it because he used it all these years. It's his trademark, it's his slogan, he's entitled to use it. So they came in here, they bought an existing practice that were competing with Dr. Love all these years, right? There was a practice in Oakdale that existed. What'd they do? They spent $1.4 million competing with Dr. Love. $1.4 million. You just heard counsel put that up. He added it up for you. $1.4 million of advertising dollars to compete with Dr. Love's plastic surgery business. And then what did he say? When there was confusion, she came to our office, right? Witness came in to our office. They didn't send her to Dr. Love. What'd they do? They sold her. They tried to sell her on their procedures. He says it wasn't a hard sell. What'd they do? They said, you don't want Dr. Love cutting your face. You don't want Dr. Love doing these procedures. You don't want Dr. Love, a non-certified surgeon, taking care of you for these procedures. You want us. Right? How many other patients came in for that hard sell? He wants to call it a soft sell. It sounds pretty hard to me. Ladies and gentlemen, this is New York City coming into Central City and beating up on a small practitioner who's been taking care of patients in this community for 2 decades. And no one's ever complained about Dr. Love's procedures. In fact, it's just the opposite. His procedures have been well regarded by his patients, and he's been successful until they came in and outspent him and out-advertised him using his slogan and, frankly, his name. Thank you, Governor.
Thank you.